The following program originally aired in November of 2009 on NPA-TV. The program featured an in-flight first-hand look of a B-17 Flying Fortress. The plane was named the 909 and was piloted by Mac McCauley. Tragically, on October 2, 2019, at Bradley International Airport in Connecticut, shortly after takeoff, there was a malfunction on board. The Flying Fortress came in low, touched down 1,000 feet short of the runway, clipped the instrument landing system antenna array, veered across the runway, across a grassy area and taxiway, and crashed into a de-icing facility at approximately 9:54 a.m. Seven occupants, including both pilot Mac McCauley and co-pilot Michael Foster, perished in the crash. Six people were injured, including a man on the ground. We dedicate this program to the memory of those who were killed and their families. May they rest in peace.
Hi, this is Ted Mulvehill, Director of Veteran Services for the town of Norwood. We're at historic Plymouth Airfield today, Plymouth Airport, where the Collings Foundation has had a display for the last few days of three historic World War II aircraft. The B-17 Flying Fortress that you see behind me, and also on the apron are a B-24 Liberator, another heavy bomber, and a P-51 Mustang fighter plane. A remarkable display of history and technology from the World War II era. Brian Walker has joined me today. We're going to document a wonderful event where we're actually on the flight manifest. We're going to be flying in the B-17 from Plymouth and landing in Norwood Airport close to 2 o'clock this afternoon. An amazing opportunity for NPA-TV to get an up close and personal look at a vintage World War II aircraft, a piece of history, and a vital part of the efforts in World War II that enabled us to be victorious. This is a great personal time for me as well. My father was actually a B-17 pilot and flew 31 missions during World War II. So I'm going to get to ride in my dad's aircraft and I couldn't be more excited. It's going to be a great day. Sit back and enjoy the show.
We have a rare opportunity to explore and learn more about this unique and rare treasure of aviation history. The B-17 is one of only 9 in flying condition in the United States. So let's take a look. Talk about specifications. The wingspan, 103 feet, 9.3 inches. Length, 74 feet, 9 inches. Empty weight, 36,135 pounds. And she's 19 feet, 1 inch tall. The maximum weight is 72,000 pounds. And the maximum service ceiling is a height of 35,000 feet. Range, 2,400 miles. Carries a crew of 10. The tail markings indicate the original 909, which was assigned to combat on February 25th, 1944. Armament, 13 M2 50 caliber Browning machine guns. Individual donors who make substantial contributions to the maintenance and upkeep of the plane are honored with having their names painted on the side of the fuselage. Powered by 4 1,200 horsepower Wright R-1820-97 engines. It's a heck of a power plant. The maximum speed of the aircraft is 250 miles an hour. Close-ups of these power plants show the size and incredible power of those 1,200 horsepower engines. Just forward of the engine nacelles and on the upper deck of the main fuselage is the cockpit. Pilot, co-pilot, the instrument panel restored to its original condition. This aircraft is flown by wire, not computer. Yoke and wheel driven, throttles to the left of the co-pilot, main throttles in the center console, altimeters, stabilizer, pressure gauges, all clearly visible and restored to their original condition. Although the original equipment and controls were used for operations on board in accordance with FAA regulations had to be
modern avionics for communications with the various flight control towers across the Northeast. Pilot and co-pilot visibility forward of the aircraft was limited due to the angle of the fuselage. On the lower deck, underneath the pilot and co-pilot, were the stations for the bombardier, who sat farthest forward, and the forward gunners. Specially adapted optical glass for the bombardier to assure accuracy for the bomb sight. And you can see the 50 caliber machine guns bristling from the nose of the aircraft, two below the bombardier and one on either side of him. 50 caliber Browning machine guns. The bomb sight, top secret technology of its day, played the most prominent role in the accuracy and efficiency of the bombing raids by this aircraft. Boxes and boxes of 50 caliber rounds throughout the aircraft ensured continuous fire, protecting the aircraft from all sides during flight operations and while under attack by enemy fighters. Controls and technical sighting aids for the bomb sight, oxygen at altitude was necessary. Stations throughout the aircraft ensured the crew's safety and health. The placement and utilization of the four forward 50 caliber machine guns ensured the safety of the aircraft against any oncoming enemy fighters. The top turret gunner, mounting twin 50 caliber machine guns, was able to rotate his turret 360 degrees, offering maximum protection both above, behind, and to either side of the aircraft during dogfights. During World War II, United States Army Air Corps enlisted personnel who were somewhat shorter in stature were often hand-picked to man the ball turret gun below the aircraft. Again, mounted twin 50 caliber machine guns, encased in a gimbaled ball enclosure, able to rotate 90 degrees on the vertical axis and 360 degrees on the horizontal axis, the responsibility for the safety of the aircraft from below rested solely upon the shoulders of this gunner. Looking down the barrel of that 50 caliber, 13 stations on board this aircraft made enemy fighters think twice about taking on one of these B-17s. Areas of responsibility for the port and starboard sides of the fuselage of the aircraft rested with these individual single 50 caliber machine guns. Deadly accurate, highly lethal, feared by enemy pilots. Dead aft of the aircraft, his external sight clearly visible, this twin 50 caliber machine gun mount was responsible for those enemy aircraft who thought they may take the B-17 by surprise from behind. Isolated by position from the rest of the aircraft, his only communication with his crewmates was through the intercom system throughout the aircraft. Seen through the bomb bay doors are the control wires from the pilot to the wing flaps and ailerons, indicating the true nature of the fly-by-wire design of this aircraft. 12 500-pound TNT bombs filled the bomb bay and rained down death and destruction upon enemy targets during missions. Hydraulically operated bomb bay doors assured the smooth delivery of the payload to the targets below. Hand-painted messages to the enemy added a personal touch to these 500-pound weapons of destruction. Radio transponders, tube-operated, transceivers, power units, frequency modulators, faced the rear of the aircraft, powered by multiple units, generator and battery driven. Avionics monitors and a large electrical fuse box
assured power throughout the aircraft. This aft view shows the tight crew quarters and cramped conditions the crew endured while in flight. Passengers riding on the B-17 in the current day are forced to sit on the floor for accommodations until the aircraft is airborne. At the aft of the fuselage shows the piston for the tail landing gear, beyond which lies, literally, the station for the tail gunner. Rolling out from the apron as we taxi down the runway towards takeoff, one could truly appreciate the power of those 1,200 horsepower engines as the RPMs rose and we began to roll down the runway. Rapidly gaining takeoff speed, the aircraft nosed smoothly into the sky, barely perceptible. The roar of the engines was incredible as we slowly climbed and left the Plymouth Airport behind. According to instructions, as soon as the tail landing gear retracted, we were able to move about the aircraft, which we wasted little time in doing. Cranberry bogs, forests, ribbons of highway below. We were airborne. Communications were limited due to the roar of those huge engines, but instinctively we both knew what each other was saying. What an incredible experience. As we greeted our two fellow passengers, Ryan and I knew it was time to move forward and explore the aircraft while it was in flight. We had no idea what to expect and were totally unprepared for what we encountered. Mid-fuselage, an open window threatened to take my hat. I encouraged Ryan to experience the slipstream himself while holding on to a very expensive piece of video equipment. One of our favorite shots of the day ensued. This is probably the very same view that the top ball turret gunner experienced while in flight and while in combat. A perfect day, a beautiful sky framed the rear of the aircraft as we motored towards Norwood. Per the captain's instructions, those wires were strictly off limits, do not touch. A 6-inch wide catwalk brought us through the bomb bay towards the front of the aircraft. Not a lot of room to maneuver, and a very narrow walkway. The top ball turret gun offered an unparalleled view of 360 degrees. You've got to get up there. Again, our intrepid videographer braved life and limb to present this unbelievable view, a panorama while in flight. Again, I think Ryan and I only had regrets that we couldn't provide an adequate expression of just how loud those engines are. They are loud. Crawling forward below deck to the bombardier station and forward gunner platform. We were truly as far forward as one could get, squeezing into the tiny bombardier seat. I had a true appreciation of just how narrow and cramped quarters these flyers operated under. As we spoke later, Ryan and I commented we could only imagine what the reaction of the neighborhoods below must have been to see a 60-year-old aircraft smoothly motoring overhead on a beautiful sunny day. Even exceptional video footage such as this fails to capture the power behind each of these individual power plants. The sheer strength and power that they present while in flight. The absolute sense of stability and safety of each of those engines has to be seen to be truly appreciated. Standing behind the pilot in the midst of flight operations, I had visions of my father as a 22-year-old young flyer commanding this aircraft while under battle conditions over the hostile skies of Germany. It was a very special and moving moment. First Route 3 north, then 128 stretched below us. As we flew over Norfolk County, nearing our home, we were both amazed and exhilarated at the experience we had just had. Flying over Norwood, I got a great sense of personal pride at being a citizen and resident of our great community and being able to see it from such a unique perspective. As the B-17 touched down and we rolled out, both Ryan and I were nearly overcome with emotion for the once-in-a-lifetime experience that we had just been granted.
Wow, that was intense. Thank you, baby. It's a good aircraft, good solid American-made steel. Man, we'll talk more.
Ryan, We just got off of this airplane we're standing in front of. I'm kind of at a loss for words, but I want to get your impressions. First of all, let me tell the folks watching this at home that once we took off at Plymouth Airport, and we were sitting in the back on the floor of the cargo area, and once that tail wheel retracted up into the fuselage, the seat belts were off, and we were crawling around in that aircraft like a couple of monkeys. We had free rein, the plane was empty, and it was just Ryan and I pretty much, and as you can see from the footage, it's just a remarkable experience. What are your thoughts on that?
You know, I'm speechless. It was a great experience. It was remarkable is a great word to describe it. It was something, a piece of history that we got to experience for that flight from Plymouth here to Norwood. And I feel very fortunate to experience it, but it certainly was a piece of history that we could share.
It's an amazing thing. I got to share one quick story with the viewers. When we were walking forward through the fuselage, the middle of the aircraft, if you can see it right here behind us, is open. And as we got through, my hat almost went southbound. And because Ryan's a couple inches taller than me, his hat almost went out the air, out into the airspace too. So
I actually almost lost the camera. I put the camera up through there. I thought I was going to lose it.
The slipstream was pretty intense. It was a loud, loud ride. Those four engines, they put out 1,200 horsepower each. And when they throttle up, baby, you know it. And you can feel it in your chest just vibrating away. That was part of the experience as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was funny too, when the engines had first started, it was very loud, and you had looked at me and said, you haven't seen anything yet, buckle up. And it was certainly, it got tremendously loud in there, but, you know, welcome just to a welcomed experience.
Yeah.
Just to be in there, you know.
I'll tell you, I can't think of anybody else I would have ridden with, buddy. It was a great pleasure. Thanks.
Absolutely.
And special thanks to NPA-TV. I tell you, the opportunity of a lifetime, and I'm glad you were you were my partner.
I appreciate it. I'll have you as my co-pilot any day.
There you go. Okay, we'll throw it back to you.
Frederick A. Thornley. You can see his name inscribed on the side of this B-24 Liberator, one of the heavy bombers from World War II. And here, in fact, is Mr. Thornley. Mr. Thornley, tell us a little about your experiences while you were in this bird.
I'd like to read one story. And it happened in August, but the mission was in July 28th, 45. And we went up and hit Curie Naval Base. They had a big dry dock up there, and they were building two-man submarines. And we went up there to naturally destroy them. We lost a couple of aircraft. One was a Lonesome Lady, formed by a fellow, Tom Cartwright. He was the pilot. And when they got hit, he told his crew to bail out, which they did. And they all got out without any problems. But of course, they were scattered because of the speed of the aircraft and all. And Tommy, for 2 days, roamed around in the woods, wondering what to do. He certainly couldn't pass for a job. So he decided to give in, and so he waited one time when one lonesome fella came up. He kind of indicated it was a path, and he jumped out in front of him, and he scared the hell out of the guy. But the fella was shaking, and Tommy had his 45, but he had taken the ammunition out and thrown it away so he wouldn't get shot by his own weapon. And laid it down on the ground and backed up with his hands in the air. And finally the guy realized that he wanted to give up, so he escorted him into town. And there, a couple of Tommy's people were present, and a couple of Navy men in the jail where they were.
Oh, yeah.
Finally, all of Tommy's crew got in the jail, along with four Navy men. The town was Hiroshima.
Holy smokes.
That was the 28th, so in the early part of the week of August, they kept interrogating Tom of when is the invasion gonna happen? Well, none of us knew when the hell they were even going to have one, you know.
That's right, sure.
And so we didn't know. And 2 days before the bomb, Tommy Cartwright and two of the Navy men were put on a train and taken to Tokyo.
Wow.
He was the only survivor of his crew because of that.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's incredible. 2 days before.
Yeah.
Boy, that's cutting it a little too close.
Yeah.
A little too close.
You often wondered, and Tommy, after the war, became very friendly with one of the Japanese over there, and they were together for quite a while, back and forth with what happened and how it happened, the bombing and all.
Sure. Boy, that's really, that's a very special story, Jim. What was your job on this aircraft?
I sat up in the nose.
In the nose, yeah?
Yeah, I told the pilot which way to steer.
What a good guy. And you brought him home safe every time.
Oh, thank God.
There you go.
But my crew's all gone now. Up in the nose, my job there was to, we flew a lot of lead ship. Yeah. We had a good bombardier. And when the flak started to come up, I would tell the pilot, flak on its way, you know, so he could start his, his turning, you know.
Tell me how your name got on this aircraft.
My son, Jimmy.
Nice job.
He got a lot of money. Well, I had a lot of money. Put it on there for me.
Well, that's a great honor.
Yeah.
You must be very pleased.
Oh, I am.
And very proud. And you must be proud, too.
Sure we are.
Of course you are. Well, that's a great story. I want to thank you very much for taking
the
time to speak with us.
You're welcome.
We'll make sure that you get a copy of this.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. Yeah. And hi, we're joined by Mac McCauley. Mac is the pilot of the 17 that flew Ryan and I up from Plymouth Airport. Mr. McCauley, please tell us your impressions on what it's like to fly that aircraft for the Collings Foundation.
Oh, well, it's a great honor to fly for the foundation. We get an opportunity to fly a lot of the veterans and their families around, which is basically why we're doing this. The Collings Foundation, being an educational foundation, is dedicated to that preservation. Flying the airplane itself is a real honor. It's a lot. It's different than pretty much anything else you fly today. It's all pulling a cable. You know, there's all a little bit of muscle involved, and you kind of got to hog it around once in a while. But you know, she's a good old airplane, and she flies every single day. She loves to fly.
You provided Ryan and I with an opportunity of a lifetime bringing us up today. And the Collings Foundation is a nonprofit, and we view these as living museums. Would you agree with that assessment?
Oh, absolutely. You know, we're very fortunate that we can bring these around to the people rather than having them sitting in an isolated spot in a museum where only a few people can see them a year. And we give them the opportunity, they can actually go for a ride in the airplanes and walk through and tour the airplanes. It's $12 for adults, $6 for children. You can ride in the airplanes for $125 for the heavy bombers, and you're only seated for takeoff and landing. The rest of the time you're running around the airplane and getting to see the different positions as the crew guys were in and what they went through. It's a little bit smaller than most people see on TV, but it's a lot of fun. It's a great experience, and we hope more people do it.
Captain, we're encouraging everyone we know to come down and see you. Thank you very, very much for taking the time, and thanks for an unbelievable flight.
Well, thanks for coming with us.
Thanks. Mac McCauley from the Collings Foundation. We're here with the airport manager, Russ McGuire, and Russ is an aviator himself. And Russ, I'd like to get your thoughts on what it means to have the Collings Foundation come back to the airport and bring these wonderful vintage aircraft to Norwood.
Well, we're pretty excited about it because the last time that the Collings Foundation was here, I want to say it was about 6-7 years ago. And it seems every time the Collings Foundation shows up at Norwood, we have a very good turnout here. The town has always been very supportive of this event. In fact, if we don't bring them back in a successive year, we end up getting a lot of phone calls from the community asking when we're going to bring them back. So this event this year is about 6 or 7 years overdue. And as you can see from the turnout already, we've got a lot of folks that are pretty excited about being here. So,
well, it is, and it's a very exciting thing. And give me your perspective, Russ, from a flyer's point of view. When you see these aircraft, what comes into your mind?
Well, I think you know the marketing adage that the Collings Foundation uses is that this is a living museum. So, for anybody who's even remotely interested in aviation, and certainly for those of us who are in aviation. To be able to see these machines up close and personal is pretty exciting. Even when you're doing it every day as we do, to see these aircraft that were flying in World War II, and to see the that they can still fly, and they can perform pretty impressively. It's exciting. I think it's exciting for everyone. So we never get those of us who work in the industry never get too jaundiced to get excited about the technology that was really really helped to win the war 60 years ago.
That's right. So. It is exciting, Russ. Listen, thanks for taking the time to speak with us. Russ McGuire, the Norwood Airport manager, flyer himself. We're standing behind an unbelievable display of aircraft, so we encourage everybody to please come on down and take a look at these wonderful living museums.
Well, I guess for starters, it's an older plane, obviously, so it's a little scary. It's shaky and everything, but we tried to just capture the moment, myself and Teddy, and the camera work was certainly not my best, but it's par for the course, and it's a little shaky, but it was just an unbelievable experience just to be inside of one of those, and then actually to have it, you know, be inside up in the air. It's just ridiculous. I was able to stick my head out the window up top. Teddy almost actually lost his hat. We really didn't know the window was open until we were underneath it. I almost lost the camera. I stuck the camera up there and almost lost the camera, but I held on for dear life to that. But yeah, it was amazing. It was, you know, the propellers are right next to the windows, the closed windows, which is a good thing. But being that close, it's just can't even describe it. It was a great experience. The sound when we were on the ground and they were just starting the engines up was extremely loud, and so, but manageable. So we figured, yeah, that's not too bad. And then when we were up in the air, it was extremely loud. It was windy. There's with the gunner stations need to pivot, so there are open small cracks, open spaces. So the wind was coming in. The engines are really, really loud. So we weren't able to capture the audio while we were in flight, but nevertheless, it was great. To look back and see what the kids had to work with that fought for our country, and it's something special, and they truly are the greatest generation, and they are absolute heroes. The sacrifice that they gave, and you just can't even put it into words. I can't even describe it. I'm grateful to have the opportunity to be inside an aircraft like that, and to the heroes that have defended our country for so many years.
Well, it's difficult to try and find some good closing remarks for this this remarkable event today. Ryan and I had an extraordinary afternoon. Not just the flight, which was almost indescribable, but meeting and talking with the greatest generation. Some of the men that are here today flew on these aircraft, and some of the men that are here today lost friends during the war that flew in these aircraft. And it's just a humbling experience to be able to meet and talk with these gentlemen. I'm blessed in my job. I get to do it almost every day. But this is a particular breed of soldier, an airman, that flew these aircraft under extraordinary circumstances and very, very hazardous missions. And to be able to meet them is a great honor for both Ryan and myself. Also, as I mentioned earlier, a great personal connection for me. This photograph that I'm holding is a picture of the Argonaut II. This is a B-17G model, exactly the same aircraft as I'm standing in front of and that we flew in today. And this gentleman in the back row, second from the right, is my father, Ted Mulvehill Sr.
Dad was a captain in the Army Air Corps and flew this aircraft. He flew 31 missions over Germany and was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross, as well as several air medals for his service to our nation. So meeting his colleagues and his contemporaries in this setting, near this aircraft, on board this aircraft, to be able to fly in this aircraft, had a great personal connection to me, and I want to thank NPA-TV for giving me this wonderful opportunity. So we hope you've enjoyed this very, very special show, and certainly has been a labor of love for me. And for Ryan Walker and all of NPA-TV, this is Ted Mulvehill, Director of Veteran Services for the town of Norwood. Keep them flying. The Callings Foundation, keeping history alive. The Callings Foundation is a nonprofit educational foundation, 501c-3, founded in 1979. The purpose of the foundation is to organize and support living history events that enable Americans to learn more about their heritage through direct participation. Since 1989, a major focus of the foundation has been the Wings of Freedom tour of World War II aircraft. This tour showcases three fully restored bomber aircraft, a B-24 Liberator, a B-17 Flying Fortress, and a B-25 Mitchell. The newest addition to the Wings of Freedom tour is a World War II P-51C Mustang dual-control fighter aircraft. The Wings of Freedom tour has two goals: to honor the sacrifices made by our veterans that allow us to enjoy our freedom, and to educate the visitors, especially younger Americans, about our national history and heritage. The foundation encourages people to tour the planes, talk to the veterans who come to visit the aircraft, and participate in a flight experience. In 19 years, the tour has made more than 2,195 visits to airports across the United States and Alaska. While the exact number of visitors is difficult to gauge, it's estimated that between 3 and 4 million people see these warbirds annually. The foundation depends solely upon private funding, receiving donations from individual members, as well as the people who visit the aircraft in each city and town. For contact information, please write the Callings Foundation, P.O. Box 248, Stowe, Massachusetts, 01775, or on the web, www.callingsfoundation.org.
The program you have just been watching originally aired in November of 2009 on NPA-TV. The program featured an in-flight first-hand look of a B-17 Flying Fortress. The plane was named the 909 and was piloted by Mac McCauley. Tragically, on October 2nd, 2019, at Bradley International Airport in Connecticut, shortly after takeoff, there was a malfunction on board. The Flying Fortress came in low, touched down 1,000 feet short of the runway, clipped the instrument landing system antenna array, veered across the runway, across a grassy area and taxiway, and crashed into a de-icing facility at approximately 9:54 a.m. Seven occupants, including both pilot Mac McCauley and co-pilot Michael Foster, perished in the crash. Six people were injured, including a man on the ground. We dedicate this program to the memory of those who were killed and their families. May they rest in peace.